In this video, we're looking at what happens to the motion of an object depending on the relative alignment of the acceleration and velocity vectors. So on the left, we have the one-dimensional cases, and on the right, we have the two-dimensional cases, just to generalize things. And of course, we start with the one-dimensional cases, and in the first picture, I have a cart that's moving to the right and is also accelerating to the right, and I'm trying to figure out what happens to the motion of this thing. And just as a reminder, the average acceleration, so we're just considering finite chunks of time here, the average acceleration is going to be the change in the velocity divided by the change in the time. Now in one dimension, we normally deal with direction by using plus and minus signs, but these are technically vectors. And so what happens in a small chunk of time is that acceleration causes the velocity to change, and I can just solve for delta v here. Delta v is my acceleration vector multiplied by a change in time, delta t. And so that vector on the right-hand side has simply been scaled by a factor of delta t, and that can't change its direction. So my delta v must point in the same direction as a. And there's my little delta v, and what I'm doing here is taking the change in velocity and vector adding it to the original velocity. So I arrange them head to tail, and then I draw a new velocity vector from the tail of the first to the head of the second. That's v plus delta v, and I can see that that's longer than the original velocity. In other words, our conclusion here is if the acceleration points in the same direction as the velocity, then the speed goes up. So this thing is speeding up. In the second case, I have an acceleration vector opposing the direction of the velocity vector. And we do all the same stuff. I want to be able to solve for delta v as a times delta t. And then I realize the change in my velocity here is going to point in the same direction as a, which is to the left. And that's opposite the direction of the original velocity vector. And when I vector add these two things, so I'm going to pick up my delta v and put the tail of it on the head of v. Then the vector pointing from the tail of v to the head of my little delta v is going to be shorter than the original v. And I discover that my object is slowing down. So whenever the acceleration vector points opposite to the velocity vector, you're looking at an object that's slowing down. So what happens when we extend this to two dimensions? In the pictures on the right, I have sort of three different cases of relationships between acceleration vectors and velocity vectors in a two-dimensional space. And the key to understanding this is to break that acceleration vector into components. So in the first one, there's a bit of a component pointing in the same direction as the velocity vector. And we call that a parallel. It's the parallel component of my acceleration vector. And there's a component pointing perpendicular to the velocity vector. And it's still true that the change in my velocity vector is given by my acceleration vector times delta t. But if I write my acceleration vector as a sum of these two components, I get an a parallel times delta t plus an a perpendicular times delta t. And then I see that a parallel times delta t points in the same direction as the original vector v. So that's the first contribution to the change in the velocity vector. I'll call that delta v parallel. And at this point, I already see that my speed has increased. And I still have to add to that this vector component. So a perpendicular times delta t. Well, that points in the same direction as a perpendicular. It gives me a little chunk like this. That's my delta v perpendicular. So when I vector add these two vectors, I have a vector that's both longer, but is also rotated clockwise. And the way to think of this is that parallel component of a is controlling the speed. And if that points in the same direction as v, my speed goes up. This perpendicular component of a, that controls the turning of the velocity vector. In this case, it made the velocity vector turn clockwise. Let's see what happens in the second case. So again, I want to think about components of this acceleration vector relative to the direction of the velocity vector. So I'm decomposing with respect to these axes. And I have an a parallel that's pointing opposite the direction of v. And I have an a perpendicular that's pointing up this way, again, perpendicular to the direction of v. And again, if I multiply by a little delta t, that parallel component contributes a change in the velocity vector that goes this way, opposing the original direction. That's my delta v parallel. That's going to make the speed go down. And I'm vector adding three vectors here. So when I tack on that perpendicular velocity change, I start from the head of the second vector here and move in the direction of a perpendicular to get my little delta v perpendicular. And the resulting velocity vector points from the tail of the first to the head of the last in that vector sum. and there's my new velocity vector v plus delta v. So in this case, that parallel component of the acceleration vector made the velocity vector shrink. So it slowed it down because that acceleration is opposing the direction of the velocity. And then the perpendicular component, again, caused the velocity vector to turn clockwise. So what do we do with the third case? In the third case, I have a very special case where the acceleration vector is perpendicular to the velocity vector. And this means there is no parallel component to cause the speed to change. So this is a critical point. If you find yourself in a situation where the acceleration is perpendicular to the velocity, then the speed will stay the same. So then the only question really is, which way is this thing turning? And I can get that really quick qualitatively. A little change in velocity would be in the same direction as the acceleration vector. And my rotated velocity vector would look like this. Now you might complain that v plus delta v is the hypotenuse of a triangle, so it must be longer than the original v. But what's happening here is I'm assuming this a continues to stay perpendicular to v as it rotates. So after an infinitesimal amount of time, the a has rotated a little bit. And it's always staying perpendicular to v throughout this rotation process, so v can't grow longer. And by doing this quick qualitative analysis, we figured out that what we're looking at is a velocity vector that stays constant in length but is always rotating counterclockwise. And the reason this example is so important is that that's exactly what's going to happen in uniform circular motion. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.